As I look back over the years in both the United States and the Philippines, where I've lived quite a bit, the subject of dreams, interpretations of dreams, people who claim that they can do this or believe that there's a meaning behind their dreams, this topic has come up so consistently over the years. Now, in the United States, there's sort of a an open-mindedness about it. People, like especially during the whole New Age movement, right about post-70s into the 80s, people were into, you know, the healing powers of crystals and pyramids and of course, dream interpretation, mediums, all this kind of thing. So it begs the question in this channel's context, well, what does the Bible say about dreams and visions? Now, the first thing we should do is, of course, define our definitions. There is a difference between dreams and visions. And the easiest way to classify the two is dreams happen when you're asleep, you're unconscious, and visions are something that you would see in your waking hours. Now, let's start with dreams. First, we'll look at where, because everybody always says, well, I had this dream and I have this strong feeling it means this or it means that. You know, God wants me to take this job or God wants me to start that business, whatever. And then they'll say, and you know, it says that, but you know, God talks to us in our dreams. So that is true, but we're going to look at that in more detail. So three good examples of God speaking to somebody in a dream. You see that in the Old Testament, twice in Genesis and then once in Daniel. Now, the first one is one of my favorite, you know, Bible accounts, and it's the story of Joseph. In fact, there was a play done years ago called Joseph and the Amazing Technicolor Raincoat or something like that. But it was essentially a play that was built off of the story of Joseph. Now, I'll give you the quick rundown. Joseph was one of many sons, might have even been his 11 brothers, again, it's been a while since I read it. But he had all these other older brothers, and he was his dad's favorite, and all the other brothers knew it. So they were kind of jealous of him. And he had this really nice coat that his dad had given him, and so that was like the camel that broke the straw, or was. So that was like the straw that broke the camel's back for the brothers. So they plotted and said, you know, that's it. We're tired of him. Let's just get rid of him. And they actually plotted and thought, well, let's kill him. But then they took him out to the desert, and then they talked about it among themselves, and some of them were like, no, this is crazy. We can't kill our own brother. So then the guys said, well, there's a big hole over there. So then we can't kill our own brother. So then this, you know, merchant comes by, and next thing you know, they've sold him into slavery. And the slave takes possession of Joseph, you know, in exchange for some money to the brothers, and ends up selling him to this rich guy. And so there's Joseph trying to make the best of his situation. And next thing you know, when the guy who purchased him is off doing whatever he does for work, the guy's wife says, whoa, you know, Joseph's pretty good looking guy. And she gets the hots for Joseph. But Joseph is like, no. You know, I'm not going to do that. Not interested. You know, violates my belief in God, and I couldn't do that to your husband, even though he's got me working as a slave, and turns her down. So, of course, being jilted, she gets all ticked off. And when the husband comes home, she says, well, look at this slave that you hired. He tried to rape me. So the guy calls the police. Now, next thing you know, Joseph is there in Egypt, in jail. And he's languishing away for quite a while. And then it comes about that some of the other prisoners, you know, are saying, wow, I had the wackiest dream last night. And Joseph was like, well, tell me what the dream was. And they go, well, you know, this and that in the dream. And Joseph says, oh, well, that means you're going to get released here pretty soon. And sure enough, pretty soon, that prisoner, he was released. So then some other guy has a dream and says, oh, I saw this and this and this. And Joseph's like, yeah, this is not going to end well for you. And once again, his interpretation of the dream comes true. So he gets this reputation as a person who can interpret dreams. And this is obviously a gift given by God to Joseph. So the first thing we want to look at is that this is a very unique case. This is a gift given to Joseph, something that is more than humanly possible. And you can liken it to the extension of power that God gave to Moses during his time. Moses, as we all know, you know, brought all the plagues upon Egypt and parted the Red Sea when the Egyptians were chasing the children of Israel and all that. But see, the thing we got to keep in mind is this was a special instance with one man. It does not mean that everyone who believes in God can interpret dreams. It does not mean that everybody who believes in God can part the ocean. So always keep that in mind when you look at this. The assumption or the conclusion we cannot make is, oh, well, if God did it for Joseph or Moses or Elijah, well, then he's doing it for me. He'll do it for me, too. He'll give me that gift, too. No, that is the wrong way to interpret the Bible. Again, you have to look at this. This is a unique situation. So anyways, long story short, the Pharaoh is having this dream. It's really bugging him. And one of the slaves who had been in the prison, who is now working in the Pharaoh's court, mentions to a guy who mentions to the Pharaoh, hey, this lowlife over here, he was in one of our jails, and he says there's a guy in our prison who can interpret dreams and did it correctly and yada yada. So, of course, the Pharaoh says, well, clean this guy up and get him in front of me. I got to find out what's going on because this dream is just keeps coming back and it's driving me. So meanwhile, there's a famine in the land and, you know, times are tough. And Joseph's brothers and father, you know, everybody's on food rationing. So they clean up Joseph and drag him in front of the Pharaoh. And Pharaoh tells him the dream. And Joseph says, well, what you got coming here is 7 years of a bountiful harvest, and then 7 years of an even worse famine. And so the Pharaoh believes him and says, well, if that's the interpretation of my dream, what can I do about it? And, you know, Joseph says, well, I mean, if it was me, you know, since you're asking me, why don't you build up some big silos, save up the grain while times are good, and then, you know, again, ration it out during the famine. So Pharaoh's like, you know, you're a pretty sharp cookie. Okay, you just got promoted. And next thing you know, Joseph has got this really high position in the Pharaoh's court handling the food supply for Egypt. It's a really great account because eventually the brothers are brought forward, you know, they're coming forward during the time of famine to get their allotment of grain, and they don't recognize their own brother. Years have passed by, and now he's all dressed really, you know, professional, at least in the fashion of the Egyptians at the time. And they don't recognize that Joseph is the chief honcho who's organizing the whole food distribution program. But Joseph recognizes his brothers. So everybody's supposed to get whatever, say 2 kilos a person per family or whatever, you know, and they're only supposed to get a certain amount when they come for grain. And Joseph tells the distributor guys that are handing out the grain, okay, you see these 11 guys right here? Give them double, give them more than what they, you know, because he wanted to, you know, do good by his family, even though they screwed him over, threw him under the bus. So when they get home, they're like, oh no, they gave us too much grain. There must have been a mistake. We better bring this up. Otherwise, the Pharaoh's going to accuse us of stealing or, you know, deceiving to get extra food. This could really screw us up. So they go back again, and then they end up in front of their own brother Joseph, like begging for mercy, like, hey, we're bringing this to your attention, and you know, this wasn't anything that we did on purpose, and you know, we just want to know everything's cool. And there's Joseph looking at his brothers. And by the way, this was all part of Joseph's first dream before they threw him, you know, to the slave master, before they traded him off as a slave. He told, this is what like caused all the problems, is Joseph told his brothers, I had this dream that all you guys were bowing down to, and he's the youngest brother. So skip forward, and it's happening. All the brothers are down on their face begging Joseph, who they don't know it's Joseph, to have mercy and pity on them. So finally, you know, Joseph is in a position now where he could really get some payback. He could say, okay, all you guys go to prison. Let's see how you like it. But he didn't. He sent out all the other servants, and when everybody was gone, except for his brothers, in fact, they even told him, go back and bring your father back here. So they had to go back and bring their father back. And then when all this happened, then he revealed himself. He's like, hey, it's me. It's me. Everything I told you about in that dream, remember a long time ago before you sold me as a slave? It all came true. But you know what? And here's the key to the whole thing. Joseph says, what you did out of evil motives, God worked it out for good. Now, that didn't mean that their evil was any less evil. It's simply saying, you committed evil, you did a wrong thing, but God spun it around and used Joseph to save thousands of lives of people who would have died during the famine. So anyway, so there's a good example of a dream and a person who's given the gift of interpreting a dream. Now, there's also another instance of a dream that's in Daniel chapters 2 and 4. And that involves Daniel and Nebuchadnezzar. Give you the shorter version of that. Nebuchadnezzar was a king that had really gone off his rocker. He was like off the reservation. He was pretty whacked, and he started having these dreams that his kingdom was going to, you know, grow, and that it was going to be destroyed, and that he would like be roaming around like a savage animal and all this kind of stuff. And Daniel was able to interpret the dreams and all that. Now, let's get into visions. Now, visions, as I mentioned before, are more like when you're awake. Now, a very good example of this is in the New Testament in Acts. Now, this is after Jesus has already been crucified, buried, resurrected, gone to heaven. And now the different apostles, the disciples who are now apostles, apostles. They're going out and they're preaching and whatever. And a big thing in Judaism was the food rules in the Old Testament that spoke to do not eat pork, do not eat shellfish, do not eat, you know, animals that are hooved this way, you know, only that are hooved that way, which would be like don't eat goats, but do eat sheep. There's a list. I believe it's in, I want to say Leviticus or Deuteronomy is probably where you'll find that stuff. So that Peter, being a Jew, he has this vision. And because, you know, even though they're Christians, they're basically sticking to the old Jewish dietary laws of the Old Testament. And so Peter has this vision. I believe that's in Acts 10. And God lays out, like in his vision, shows him, okay, these are all the animals of the world. And then he hears God's voice tell him, go, Peter, and eat. Kind of like a big buffet kind of thing. And Peter, right away, he sees some of those, you know, some pork, and he sees shellfish and stuff, and he's like, oh, no, you know, far be it from me. I'm never going to put that in my mouth, because Moses said, or the dietary laws state, no, we're not supposed to eat that. So God gives him this response in this vision. Do not declare unclean what I have declared to you now as clean. In other words, there was a completion of everything in the Old Testament, all the requirements for righteousness, all the requirements of the Ten Commandments, everything that could ever be demanded of a human being to be right with God was made complete in the death and resurrection of Jesus. So now it's all new rules. And even, I believe it's in the one of the Gospels, Jesus says, it's not what goes into a man's mouth that makes him unclean. It's what comes out of the abundance of his heart, out of his mouth, that makes him unclean. And so with that vision, it became then understood that after the crucifixion and resurrection, all things had been made complete. Everything that needed to be satisfied was now satisfied in this new covenant. The time of the Old Testament was the old covenant, or the old contract, the old agreement between man and God. After the resurrection is what's called the new covenant, the new agreement, the new contract, which is one of mercy and grace. The old covenant was one of legality and death. And I'll go more into the importance of that in some other episode. So there's the vision with Peter, which ended up changing things, because now you had what are called Christians, many of them who were originally Jews, but then eventually Gentiles, anybody who was non-Jewish, finding that they were already at peace with God because of the payment of Jesus' blood on the cross. So now all this other stuff about, well, you can't eat that, you can't do that, you got to see God on Saturday, not Sunday, and all this legality had been completed and set aside. And to this day, Christians can eat whatever they want. They can eat shrimp. They can eat pork. They can eat barbacoa, goat, whatever they want, because grace has now been fully provided through the cross. So now that we've taken a look at the difference between dreams and visions and how they have happened in the Bible, again, look at Peter. Peter is a unique situation. Do we see accounts of all the other disciples having visions? The only other one is John. You know, John has this vision, which I'm sure many of you have heard about. I don't know how many have read it. But the very last book of the Bible is the revelation of God. You could also read that as the vision granted to John. Now, John, out of all of the 12 disciples, technically there was 13. A lot of people don't think about this. There was the original 12 disciples that walked around with Jesus and everything. But if you remember, out of those 12, one of them was Judas. Now, after the crucifixion of Jesus, Judas felt remorse. But, and again, I'll get into this in more detail, maybe another episode, but the remorse that Judas had was a fleshly, carnal remorse. It wasn't a spiritual repentance. And so with all this grief, Judas tried to, rather than seeking the forgiveness of God directly, he tried to make it right by going back to the priest and saying, well, you know that silver you gave me here, I'm giving it back. And then these hypocritical priests who paid him to rat out Jesus to the Romans in the first place, they were like, oh no, we're too holy to take that silver. That's blood money. You got to keep it. We're not putting that in the temple. We're too holy for that. So anyway, so Judas ends up going to a tree outside of town and hanging himself. Judas tried to atone for his guilt by killing himself, punishing himself, rather than seeking out the forgiveness of God. So now the 12 disciples is down to 11. So the disciples are like, well, you know, we should have 12. So they, you know, looked at the few guys. I think there was like three or four guys who met the qualifications of having been around Jesus, witnesses Jesus, heard what Jesus said, all these things. And, well, we can only find like these three guys that fit that criteria. They prayed, and then it was like, okay, this guy. Again, you can look this up. So I believe in the book of Acts. And they said, okay, this guy, he's going to be the new replacement so that we have 12 again to replace the fact that Judas had killed himself. So now you got these 12 disciples, they're going around and spreading the good news of mercy and forgiveness from God, you know, through Jesus and all that. Well, the Roman government did not take kindly to this, and neither did the, Judaic priests. They didn't like this either. As far as they were concerned, Christianity was a cult. So it didn't take long before the Jews started rounding up the disciples and saying, well, these guys are, you know, they're radicals. They're speaking against Caesar. They're you know, because the law of the land was Caesar is God. And so it didn't take much for them to eventually round up the disciples and rat them out to the Romans and get them thrown in prison. And these guys were tortured. They were whipped. They were thrown in prison. They were tortured. You know, they eventually, I believe, all of them ended up dead, except for, getting back to the whole issue of visions, except for John. Now, I don't know if you remember, but John was described as the, I don't know if you want to use the word favorite, but it describes him as the disciple whom Jesus loved. For some reason, you know, I guess among all the disciples, as much as he had so much interaction with Peter, who was just a total hothead, John seemed to be, I guess, the most peaceful, calm, trusting, full of faith. And so John, instead of being thrown in prison and tortured like all the other 11 guys, he was put on exile on, I believe, the island of Patmos. You can look it up on the map or an old map of the area. And, you know, maybe if I find it on Google Maps, I'll include it in the notes. But so John gets exiled to the island of Patmos and ends up writing the revelation or the vision that he was given. And that was the final book of the Bible, where you can read about what he sees in the future. Now, what's really uncanny is, keep in mind, this is the first century. There was no technology. There were no computers. There wasn't even the harnessing of electricity. They didn't even have the steam engine. We're talking about very low tech. And yet, in the revelation of John, again, this is the very last book of the Bible, he's talking about the future, the time, what the time is going to look like before God comes back to call a final judgment of everybody. And here's John, first century guy, no college education, no exposure to technology. And he's talking about things like a world government so powerful, nobody can buy or sell without the government's control and approval. He's talking about things like AI. He talks about this beast, which is, it's not quite human, it's not quite demonic, but it is an entity. And it has a power to make decisions. And his only way of describing it was like, well, it's like a beast, but it's not a beast. It's an entity. And now, just since November of 2022, we've seen an explosion in artificial intelligence. And it's only been maybe 4 months since, or 5 months since this has been made available. And already, It is just multiplying upon itself. And there's already talk about it. It's already showing signs of teaching itself languages it did not know. For instance, one of the recent incidents was ChatGPT had never, you know, it understood and it figured out by language the difference between English and Spanish and German and Japanese. But there was a dialect from India that it had no exposure to. And somebody got online who spoke this very unknown small little dialect and was asking questions in its dialect. And ChatGPT figured it out, was able to piece together what it basically taught itself, that language, or at least that dialect of the Indian language, Hindi, I guess it is. So it is learning and able to teach itself. It can write computer code and then look for errors and correct them. It can optimize computer code. And so here's John with this vision talking about, for instance, another thing, that there were two witnesses. And there's a lot of debate on who these two witnesses are, but I won't get into that rabbit trail. But anyways, he mentions that there are these two witnesses who will be martyred, killed. And he says, at the same time, everyone in the world will see it in real time. Now, that's nothing new to us who grew up in the age of satellites, live TV broadcasts, something, you know, we could watch the shock and awe attack on Iraq in real time, thanks to satellite feeds and whatever. I mean, we can go on the internet and see live footage from many places in the world. You know, there's like a websites that have live cams of just live traffic cams on freeways or outside of a restaurant in Thailand or whatever. But for a guy like John in the first century, for him to say, well, two guys are going to get killed and everybody on the planet is going to see it happen, it's kind of amazing when you really stop and think about it. So you've got these unique situations where guys from the Old Testament, New Testament are having these dreams and these visions. And a lot, and as I said, a lot of people point at this and they say, well, there you go. God gave me that gift. I'm a dream interpreter. And I just don't see that, honestly. Now, I'm not saying nobody has a gift for interpreting dreams. I'm just saying it's probably three people on the whole planet. It's like that rare. And so what happens is you have all these wannabe posers who say, well, I can interpret dreams. And oh, and they get their neighbor who tells them their dream. And they're like, oh, this means God definitely wants you to not marry that woman. Or God really wants you to start a church in Guatemala. I mean, and then people run off and go, oh, really? Ooh. And then they go off and do this thing. And it turns into a total disaster because this guy doesn't know what he's talking about. Now, let's segue into this seeking of trying to get an edge, trying to get information from a dream or a vision is, I would compare it to the curiosity behind Pandora about the box. That's a whole Greek story, by the way, not in the Bible. It's a Greek mythology. But it's the curiosity people have to know something from the other side, which leads me into these people that tell you, I can interpret dreams. I can speak to your dead relatives. I can grab information from entities on the other side who can help you in your life. What are we to make of these people? Do they really have this gift of God? Are they charlatans? Or worse yet, are they actually able to communicate with what they think is your dead relative? It's probably some dark force that is doing a darn good job of impersonating your dead relative. So what does the Bible say about that? Well, as I mentioned before, there's a lot of the commands about what to do, what not to do in the Old Testament. Many of them are found in Leviticus and Deuteronomy. So in Leviticus 19, verse 31, it says, now, this is not vague. This is very clear. This is what God is telling his people on this subject. So Leviticus 19:31, God is, through the prophets, telling the people, do not turn to mediums or seek out spiritists, for you will be defiled by them. I am the Lord your God. So let's break that down, those three sentences. Number one, don't turn to these mediums or spiritists. Don't do it. Then the second part, why shouldn't you do that? Because you're going to be defiled by them. So what does it mean to be defiled? It's the same thing as when you tell your kid, you see that dog crap on the sidewalk? Don't touch it. Well, but why? Because then you're going to stink like dog crap. You're going to end up worse for it. You're going to end up stinky, and we're going to have to clean you up. So that's the reason. Don't turn to mediums or spiritists. Don't do it. Why? Because you'll be defiled by them. It's going to mess with your head and just jack up your direction in life. The third part, I am the Lord your God. This is all like the real point. The real point is not even that these spiritists are going to lead you astray and in the wrong direction. The real point is you should not be turning to these people for advice or for counseling. You're supposed to turn to me, to God. That's the point. You need advice? Pray about it. Pray to God. Ask Him for advice. Be patient. Listen. Read the Bible. Find the answer. You know, if you have the Holy Spirit, listen to what the Holy Spirit is telling you. And you have to read the Bible to kind of discern, is this the Holy Spirit or is this just me talking in my head? You got to learn to understand the difference. So the whole point in this don't turn to mediums thing, we should be turning to God for when we need advice, when we need direction. It's God we're supposed to turn to. So, you know, you go through and you get into the next chapter, Leviticus, into the 20th chapter, and 20th chapter, verse 6, the subject comes up again. And now God's giving you a warning. He says, I will set my face against anyone who turns to mediums and spiritists to prostitute themselves by following them, and I will cut them off from their people. So that's him laying down the law. He's already said, don't do it. And now he's saying, if you do it, there's gonna be consequences. Aside from these mediums leading you in the wrong direction, it's kind of like him saying, you do this. You grab that dog crap off of the sidewalk. I'm gonna go over to the peach tree. I'm going to get a switch, and I'm going to whip your behind. That's what God's saying here, basically. I'm going to set myself against you. Doesn't say he's going to condemn you. Doesn't say he's going to kill you. But he's definitely going to make your life hard. The last thing you want is God setting his face against you. You don't want to piss off God. And he says, I will cut them off from their people. Now, to us, this doesn't mean much. We're very much independent people, especially in Western culture. But in Judaism, family is everything. And that's an understatement. If you are cut off from your people, you're cut off from inheritance. You're cut off from support, from your family, from your tribe. There are 12 tribes in Israel, and everybody can trace back their family lineage to one of those 12 tribes. And that is your sort of position of honor as a Hebrew. And to be cut off from your people, God's really saying, man, this is how serious I am. Do not seek out these mediums and dream tellers and all this stuff. I'm serious. You do this, and it's like you're prostituting yourself spiritually, and I take that as a very serious offense. Now, this theme comes up again in Deuteronomy. This is Deuteronomy 18, 10 through 12. And it says, let no one be found among you who sacrifices their son or daughter in the fire, who practices divination or sorcery, who interprets omens, who engages in witchcraft or casts spells, or who is a medium or a spiritist, or who consults the dead. Anyone who does these things is detestable to the Lord. Because of these same detestable practices, the Lord your God will drive out those nations before you. So let's analyze what we just read. He's laying down the law again, saying, don't even one of you be found to doing these following lists of things. Now, the first one's kind of shocking. It says, and you would think people should, you know, not have to be told this, but believe it or not, this was a thing back then. It says, let no one be found among you who sacrifices their son or daughter in the fire. There was a for lack of a better word, satanic cult that followed after a demon god called Molech. And they had a big statue, iron statue of this god, little g, and in its belly was like a door. And then they would put a baby in there or a young child, close the door. Now it's an iron cast hollow, you know, statue. And then there was a space underneath to put fire. And this was how they would sacrifice a child to the god Molech. Now, even for a non-believer, just a regular secular human being, most people would look at that and go, man, that is really messed up. That is twisted. How messed up in the head do you got to be to do something like that? But there were people doing that. Now, just as a side note, many people say, oh, well, we wouldn't do that in today's modern society. I mean, that's illegal. That nobody would be, you know, killing off little children like that. And yet, every year in many nations, people chop up their preborn babies. They kill children for the sake of convenience. You know, the whole argument like, oh, well, but, you know, the woman that gets pregnant from a rapist, you know, often that happens, hardly ever. Most women in trauma don't get pregnant from a rapist. And the ones that do, you're talking like 1 in 100,000 of the women who get pregnant and choose to kill what they know is a baby, a child, so that they don't get inconvenience, so they can go about their life and just like, well, you know, what was I going to do? Raise a baby, be responsible, change my whole life course, quit college, all because, you know, decided to have a baby, well, decided to have sex that resulted in a baby. This whole killing of children thing happens more often than we want to admit, you know. So again, I won't get down a rabbit trail about how women say, well, it's my body, my choice. Well, okay, I'm all for that. Your body, your choice. Only problem is, if we do a DNA test on your body and the body of that baby, guess what? It's got a whole different DNA, which means it's not your body. You don't have any right to kill this other person any more than you got a right to kill your next door neighbor who has a different complete set of DNA. Now, if we're talking about you getting your appendix taken out, yeah, you do a DNA test on your appendix or your kidney, it's your DNA. Do what you want with it. But when you're talking about putting in a suction tube and ripping this baby apart, you're doing that to somebody who has a completely different set of DNA. Anyways, so let's move on with this verse. So don't go killing babies. Don't go killing your sons and daughters. Next thing is, don't practice divination or sorcery. And a lot of people might say, well, I'm not into divination. Well, guess what classifies as divination? Ever played around with a Ouija board? That's divination. That's opening yourself up to say, okay, you know, spirits, you know, it says right there on the box, just say this, you know, ask the spirits to guide you and let it move the little Ouija gadget around and get your answers from the other side. Now, what doesn't matter is whether it actually works or not. That's not what matters. What matters is a person is attempting to do this. They're attempting to divine from the other side information. Don't interpret omens. Okay, so don't get, and I really, this really is like a pet peeve of mine when people become Christians and all of a sudden everything is a sign. Well, guess what? Everything is not a sign. You know, I once knew this person, and she came to visit me, and drove up in a really nice sports car. Actually, it was a Mustang. And brand new, off the lot, she gets out of this car and she's just beaming. And now she claimed to be a Christian, but there's that whole thing, you know people by their fruits. I wasn't seeing much fruit. And what fruit I did see was pretty rotten. So anyways, she pulls up the driveway and climbs out of this brand new Mustang. And, you know, and after saying, you know, hey and hi and whatever, and I'm like, oh, you know, cool new car. That's nice. You know, that's really nice. And she goes, yeah, the Lord told me to buy it. And I was like, okay, this should be interesting. So she proceeds to tell me how she had a dream. And in the dream, God was communicating to her that she needed to buy her husband and surprise him with this brand new Mustang. She needed to do that. She needed to buy her husband a Mustang. So she went out, got on the car lot, and bought it. Now, the interesting thing is, she didn't actually buy him a Mustang. She purchased the Mustang using his money. She didn't work. He was the sole income earner. So really, if God told her to buy him a Mustang, then she should have bought him a Mustang with her money. She should have gotten a job, saved it up, and then bought him a Mustang if she really wants to say that this was a message from God, which I don't think it was. I think she wanted a Mustang, claimed she was buying it for her husband, but now she gets to drive it around while he's at work. He's not going to drive his Mustang to his landscaping business. So the whole thing just stunk seven ways to Sunday. But that's an example, and I could give you so many more of people who say, oh, this omen means this, you know, whatever. You know, I had this really good scoop of ice cream, and I believe God's telling me I should start my own ice cream shop. It's like, geez, anything's on the table at this point, so don't do it. You know, next one, don't engage in witchcraft or cast spells. I had another friend of mine. She was his wife. I used to work with him. And I went to go visit him a couple of times at their home. You know, they invited me over. And now the latest thing that his wife and his oldest daughter were into is now they're witches. You know, I don't know if you remember this, but back around the 90s, that was a big thing. You know, learning witchcraft, learning how to, you know, perform necromancy and apothecary, and how to make things happen, how to get revenge on your enemies with this spell or that spell, or how to make somebody love you or whatever. That was like a big thing in the early 90s, right about there. And here him, his wife and oldest daughter, they're doing this like a mother-daughter thing. Like, oh yeah, we're learning witchcraft. We're witches, but we're good witches. You know, we're not bad witches. You know, we're good witches. Well, God says, don't do it. You know, don't do it. Also talks about in this verse, Deuteronomy 18:10, don't let it be counted among any of you to be a medium, spiritist, or a person who consults the dead. Don't do that. Don't go consulting the dead. You need consultation. Go to God. If you happen to know somebody who is mature in their spiritual walk, a good pastor or something, then consult with them or pray. You know, Solomon says in, I believe it's Proverbs, in the multitude of counsel, there is safety. Go to three, four guys that you trust who have spiritual maturity and get their opinion. Hey, I'm thinking about whatever it is. I'm thinking about starting a business. I'm thinking about marrying this gal I've been dating, or I'm thinking about whatever, moving to Milwaukee, whatever it is. Get a multitude of counsel and then weigh it all out. But don't go to a psychic who says, well, yeah, you really trusted your dead uncle's advice. Let me see if I can get him on the line. No, don't do that. Okay, and then it finishes up with, anybody who does these things is detestable to God. Just like a parent getting back to the whole telling their toddler, don't pick up that dog crap out of the sidewalk. The second they do it, the second they start squeezing that hot dog crap in their hand, it is detestable. We just roll our eyes and look at our kid and go, oh, don't you ever listen? Couldn't you figure out on your own? This is like nasty. Don't do it. You know, and that's the reaction God has when we seek out these so-called witches and mediums and psychics for consultations that we should be going to God for. So I'll wrap up with two incidents. One that was bogus and one that makes you go, So the first instance was the bogus one. I was younger. I was about maybe 32, 33. And I was divorced. I was kind of floating in the air about my whole spiritual condition, you know, very disillusioned with the fact that I even got divorced. I was in a bad place spiritually, and I was looking for some kind of direction in life to keep me busy and keep me moving forward. So I decided, well, what the heck? You know, I've got some martial arts training. I thought, I'm going to try to get into a martial arts movie. Now, I wasn't thinking I want to become an actor, although, you know, at the time I wasn't thinking that, but the idea had crossed my mind a couple times, but I just never pursued it. But anyway, so I did what anybody else would do in Southern California. I drove down to Hollywood and I sat down and I got an agent, and I said, hey, you know, and they have this whole form and they ask you everything, you know, like, what are your skills? Can you speak other languages? Can you juggle? Can you dance? Can you sing? What can you do? So we know what kind of movies to send you for auditions to. So I listed all my stuff and, you know, I was one belt away from a black belt in Taekwondo. And so I put that down. And I told the guy, there was a movie at the time called, that had already come out, called Best of the Best. Some of you might have seen it. It was a small-time martial arts movie. And they were making a sequel. I had heard they were making a sequel. And I told him specifically, I said, hey, that sequel they're making, I said, I just want to be one of the guys in the background. I just want to be one of the guys that attacks the main character. We fight for like 3 seconds and then he knocks me out to the ground. I go, I just want to be on screen. I just want to be around these guys. I just want to be part of the whole movie making process. I go, I'm not looking for a big part, just a B part background guy who shows up on screen and gets killed in less than 10 seconds. I go, I'm okay with that. I just want, or make me one of the background competition guys. And, you know, part of the montage, and bam, I get knocked out in 10 seconds or whatever. I go, I just want to be in the movie. So he tries his best and whatever. And, you know, and so he sends me on some auditions. And on one of the days, you know, I get a call and he says, hey, you know, we got this thing. And, you know, you're up against 400 guys and it's for a Playboy commercial. And I was like, Playboy commercial? He goes, well, it's actually a 1-hour infomercial, but he goes, you're up against 400 guys, so get to this address, don't be late, or we're never sending you on another audition again. So I got there early. By the way, I got the part. They only picked four people, and I was one of the ones they picked. So somewhere out there is a one-hour infomercial. I was famous for like 2 years. Even people at the gas station were like, hey, you're that guy on the Playboy channel. So anyway, so I get there to Hollywood like an hour. Actually, it was Burbank. And I get there. Oh, no, Burbank was where we did the shooting. I get to Hollywood, and it's this big hotel. And Playboy Corporation had rented out one of the big convention rooms. Because like I said, they had like 400 guys and 400 girls that they were going to audition for the five parts that they had. And so there I am, you know, I'm there like an hour before they're even going to start letting you in the door, because I didn't want to be late. So I'm just walking around looking for something to eat. And then, you know, I'm just trying to kill time, but I'm staying near where the hotel is. And then I see this psychic, you know, this little, just a little sweet, nothing fancy, you know, but big letters on the window painted, you know, psychic. And then it had a picture of a crystal ball, very stereotypical. So I thought, I got time to kill. So I go in there and I ask the lady, and of course it's exactly what you would expect it to be. Kind of looks like a massage parlor with a whole Eastern Indian mystical vibe to it. You know, little crystal balls here and there, and crystals and whatever. And so nobody's there except for the lady running it. She's like some 40-some-year-old woman. And so she, you know, I ask her first thing, okay, how much does this cost? You know, I got an appointment in about an hour. So how much does this cost? What do I get for like $25? And she goes, well, we can do a quick consultation, see what we can see, you know. And so I'm like, okay. So we go in this little side room, you know, behind the curtain. Like I said, it was so stereotypical. It was ridiculous. And we sit down, she's got the little table and the crystal thing. And meanwhile, I've read up on all the stuff Houdini used to do to debunk all these people. You know, she starts giving me a whole bunch of vague mumbo jumbo. And then she, you know, it's Hollywood. Why do most people end up in Hollywood? Well, I won't say most, but why do many people end up in Hollywood? To be an actor, you know, an actress, to get it, make it in showbiz. And so she makes this general statement, and she says, oh, I see you in front of countless amounts of people. And I'm like, really? That's the best you can do? I mean, I'd say that, but I'm thinking that. So then after she made a couple of general proclamations, I said, can you do this for me? I mean, because, you know, you're able to see into my future. Can you tell me one specific thing from my past? You know, I mean, you know, because you do this kind of thing, that should be like no sweat for you. I mean, seeing the future, I can understand. That takes some skill. But I'm standing right in front of you. You should be able to tell me something specific about my past. So I'm basically calling her bluff. And she's trying to read me and do the whole, let's see. And she came up with some bogus answer. And I was like, well, I guess I've heard all I need to hear. I got an appointment. So I went to the audition, and yeah, they picked me. Yeah, and I ended up doing the thing. But anyways, so that was the bogus experience that I had. Now, the other experience was, to this day, I got to say, interesting. What happened was, I had been divorced for about 2 years, and I had just come out of what I will call a brutal end to a relationship. I had met a woman who... On paper, we seemed to be perfect for each other. Just perfect. Totally simpatico. And I fell head over heels in love with her. After Oh, I think it was maybe 4 or 5 months, I asked her to marry me. And she was like, well, I love you, and I'm not saying no. I'm just saying, give me a little more time to get to know you better. You know? And I was like, okay, I understand. I said, but I won't know when you're ready for me to ask you again. So I don't want to ask you again before you're ready. I said, so let's do this. I've already proposed to you. When you're good and ready, you propose to me. That way I'll know you're ready. And I said, just to know that you're really, really, really sure you want to get married, I'm asking that you propose to me 3 times on 3 different days. How's that? And she's like, that sounds like fun. Okay. So a couple months go by. One day she proposes to me. Now, by this time, both of us were going to church. She had gone from being a complete atheist to now she's going to church with me and teaching Sunday school. She doesn't even like kids, but she started teaching Sunday school. So things progress, and next thing I know, she asked me, like after church in front of, you know, other people we knew at church, to marry her. And I said, yes. Another day, not long after, it's just the two of us together. She asked me again to marry her. And I said, yes. And then the third time, we're there in front of our pastor. She asked me again to marry her. And I said, yes. So I'm on cloud 9. I'm like, oh my gosh, this woman is wonderful. You know, she went from being an atheist to becoming a believer, taking her Bible to work, telling people at work about Jesus. I'm like, wow, this is like a miracle. It is a miracle, you know? My life is turning around. This is awesome. Life is great. So we started doing premarital counseling with the pastor once a week, and we're doing this, you know. And you know, I'm, of course, a normal meat eater and whatever, and she's full-on vegetarian. So, you know, there was a lot of questions about, well, if Rike wants a hamburger, would you cook it for him? You know, questions like that. You know, so we had a lot of interesting conversations. So one day, we show up for our premarital counseling. We sit down, and I can tell something ain't right. She's not talking. And the pastor is even like, are you okay? You know, and she, without an explanation, she just stood up. She goes, I'm sorry, I just can't do this anymore. And walked out the door. So of course I followed her out. She's like, I don't want to talk. Don't talk to me. Don't contact me. Don't call me. And I'm like, wait a minute. We're engaged to get married in about 6 weeks. I mean, if something's wrong, tell me what's going on. Where's this coming from? Well, long story short, turned out she fell in love with my best friend, was spending a lot of time with him, and decided he's the guy that she's meant to marry. So now they get engaged. And so I not only lose my fiance, I lose my best friend. And now the entire church is just focused on them two. Like, oh, we're so happy for you guys, and oh, this is great, and come have dinner at the pastor's house, and let's talk about your upcoming wedding. This is awesome. And meanwhile, I'm crying my eyes out at the back of the church. I'm like a big spear was thrown through my chest. Life really sucked. I don't even want to go into the details about it. I mean, I went 7 days without eating. Just, I was so heartbroken. I used to come home from work and just, I lived alone. As soon as I closed the door behind me, I would just collapse right on the carpet. And I'd lay there till 1 in the morning, just crying, falling asleep, crying more. I mean, it was pretty bad. I was about as heartbroken as a person could be without just their heart stopping from grief. That's how bad it was. Oh, and then talk about timing. Right in the middle of all this, my father died. So this was a very bad time for me. So fortunately, there was one couple out of all these people, 2,000 or so people in the church, only one couple noticed that I was showing up every Wednesday, every Saturday morning, and Sunday night at church. Only one couple noticed that my heart had been ripped out. And God bless them, this married couple with no kids, young couple, they were like in their 30s, and I was about 35 at the time, actually maybe 33. And they took notice of me, and they began inviting me to dinner at their house or just hanging out for coffee with, you know, the guy. And now he was very accomplished as a musician. He would compose multiple tracks and do music, not necessarily Christian music, just, you know, bluesy stuff, you know, very creative guy. Kind of, he kind of reminded me of like a Puerto Rican version of Prince. Cool guy. So then his wife, she had already told me way before all this happened. She goes, I believe my spiritual gift is I am a prophetess. So I was curious. I was like, well, when you say you're a prophetess, what do you mean by that? She goes, well, I just see things how they are. That's the easiest way I can put it. She goes, I don't get visions or like go into a trance or anything. She goes, but it's like, she says, it's just a very heightened sense of discernment. But she goes, I do see things. And she goes, I know it's not just me assessing a person. She goes, I just see things the way they are. Anyway, so the advice I got from the two of them was, you know, you really got to get your mind off of your fiance, ex-fiance. You got to just accept it and move on and get yourself busy with something else, which was very good advice. So I started, looking around for something to do. And then one day after church, they said, hey, next week, we're all going to go to Tijuana, a little bit past Tijuana, not quite all the way to Rosarito. They said, we're going to all do a caravan, and we're going to, whoever wants to volunteer can go spend the afternoon on Saturday to volunteer at this orphanage. So I said, okay, yeah, I'll go. I signed the sheet and I said, I'll be here. So I got there and I get to the parking lot and I'm ready to drive there in my VW Bug. And here's this couple. They had volunteered also. So they said, well, just leave your car here. And this is like 9 a.m, Saturday. And they go, just leave your car here and ride with us. That way, you know, we can talk and chat on the way there. I'm like, yeah, cool. You know, so we're driving. And now they knew the whole story. They knew what had happened. And they're trying to cheer me up and whatever. And we're just talking about other stuff, you know, random stuff. And then after a little bit of silence, she says in a very serious tone, she goes, there's something I need to tell you that just came to me about 20 minutes ago in the middle of all our conversation. And I could tell she was like, okay, this is something serious. So I was like, okay, what is it? And she said, see, now the interesting thing is that Saturday, that day, that we're going off driving down the highway to this orphanage, that day was the day that I was supposed to be getting married to my ex-fiance. That was the day. Had things not gone south, I would have been spending that day getting married. And now I'm on a highway to somewhere in Mexico to this orphanage. So we're going down the highway. We're still heading south. And You know, so to give you the background, that's the day. So she tells me, she said, I feel compelled to tell this to you. She said, before the sun goes down today, you will meet the next woman you're going to marry. And I heard that. I thought, that has got to be the most reckless thing anybody could say to someone in my situation. Because if the sun goes down and I got my hopes up that I'm going to meet the next woman I'm going to marry today, before the sun goes down, I'm going to be destroyed if I believe what you're saying. Now, I didn't say all this, but she just said very clearly, today, Saturday, before the sun goes down, you're going to meet the woman that you're going to marry. And it scared me to hear her say that. I was like, okay, I'm open. I go, I'm just going to do what I'm going to do. We're going to get to that orphanage. We're going to do this thing and we'll see what happens. Okay. So we go to the orphanage and had kind of a goofy day. You know, they asked me, I don't know anything about bricklaying. I've seen my stepdad do it, but they told me, okay, you see those bricks over there and those sacks of cement? By myself, they go, well, build us a retaining wall. It's got to be about like 8 feet wide. So I go down there and I end up spending the whole day by myself. I'm not over there, you know, playing badminton with the kids. I'm all by myself on this piece of the property, digging a ditch, mixing cement, laying a ground foundation. You know, I'd seen my stepdad do it. And I'm laying brick and I'm trying to do it like, you know, and to me it looked perfectly level. I knew enough to use a level and a string and all this stuff. And after I got all done building about 8 feet wide, maybe five bricks high of this wall, I'm looking at it. I'm like, wow, that looks pretty damn good. It's nice and level. And then the guy who runs the orphanage comes by. He goes, what happened? I go, well, they asked me to do this, so I did it. He goes, no, look at it from this end. So I look at it from the edge of the wall. The entire thing, it is level, but it's leaning like 20 degrees, ready to fall over. I don't know how that happened, but again, I'm not a bricklayer. I'm not a mason. I totally messed it up. And I'm like, damn it. So he goes, well, tell you what, we can't salvage the cement, but pull the bricks off and we'll just do this next week or something. So I spent the rest of my time in that day pulling apart the wall that I'd built. And so I'm like, man, I came out here to get my mind off of things, and even this I can't do right. So I pulled it all apart and washed myself off, and it was time to go. And, you know, by this time it was, now this is right around June, so the days were getting a bit longer. So it was about 3:30, 4 in the afternoon, and, you know, it's time to go. And so I get together with the couple, get in their car, and I tell them what happened, whatever. And they're like, well, did anybody talk to you? You know, like maybe one of the other church girls from one of the other churches, because there was like four churches there all doing the same thing. There really wasn't enough for all of us to do. And I said, no, I didn't speak to anybody. I was just over there building that messed up wall. She was like, oh, okay. Like she wasn't worried about it at all. So we get back to the church. And now it's about, it was about 5, maybe 5:30. You know, it takes about an hour and a half, 2 hours to get back from Tijuana. And so they're like, okay, you know, and we're all just kind of ignoring the fact that she made this proclamation. I'm looking, it's like 4:30, 5 at the latest, but the sun's starting to go down. And to me, this is like blatantly obvious. It's like, if anything's going to happen, that sun's going down. Even though it's June, I got maybe 3 hours of daylight left. But she's not worried. So, you know, they both give me a hug and they go home and I jump in my car and I start driving back. And I'm like thinking, you know, I had a ways to go to get to my apartment. And I was thinking, well, I'll just do like I usually do. I'll just go to the apartment and put on my swim trunks and swim in the pool and lay in the jacuzzi and, you know, order a pizza. That'll be my day. So I'm driving down the road. And then I remember one of my best friends at work had invited me to her anniversary, her wedding anniversary party. And I knew both of them, you know, the couple. This is a different older couple that I work with. And I go, oh yeah, their anniversary parties today. And I know, I've been to her parties before, full blown out Mexican fiesta every single time. Plenty of booze and food and music. So I thought, well, you know what? Before I go home, I'm gonna go over there and stop by my friend Connie's house and go to see Connie and Moses for their anniversary. And if nothing else, at least I won't have to buy a pizza. They always put together a huge Mexican food fiesta. I thought, well, I'll just go get me a plate, listen to some music. I already know a bunch of the people that'll be there because, you know, a lot of us knew each other from work. And I thought, yeah, that'll get my mind off of things. Listen to some music. I specifically, sharply, distinctly remember what happened. I get there to their house. I park across the street. And again, there's balloons and there's a live band going in the driveway. And I cross the street and Connie sees me and throws her big arms around me. And she's like, oh, I thought you weren't going to make it, you know, and it's already now like 6:30 in the evening, you know, well, 6:30 in the evening, but it's not dark yet. You know, the sun was going to go down about 7:30 that night. So I cross the street, she gives me a big hug and she's saying, well, come on, come on, come on. You know, she was real lively, real, like just extremely gregarious. And she's like, oh, I'm glad you made it. And, you know, oh, we got to get you some food. We got to get you some food. Come on. We got chicken mole. We got rice. We got beans. We got tortillas. We got salsa. She's going, come on, come on, come on, come on. Get a plate. Get a plate. So I'm looking at her. So then we open the little gate at the driveway. And as soon as I stepped onto her property, I look forward and I see the band. And in front of the band is this beautiful woman, you know, Mexican, about 27 years old, long legs, tall as me, thick flowing black hair, beautiful Spanish eyes, slender, looks like a model. Turned out later she had done a little bit of modeling, actually not modeling, but a beauty contest. She is gorgeous, and she's singing with the band, and she is the center. She is the life of that party. She's got everybody happy. She is just got joy just pouring out of her pores. She's just sweet and joyful, big smile on her face, really happy, singing with the band. So I turn to Connie, I go, who is that? I've never seen that person before. And she goes, oh, you know, that's my good friend, but the reason you never see her is because she has this controlling husband, you know, and right away I'm like, oh. So she goes, well, she's got this controlling husband. He's super jealous, never lets her go anywhere, but he's back in Mexico right now, so she came to my anniversary party. But as soon as she said husband, I was like, oh. And she could tell I was disappointed. She goes, but they're separated. And, you know, she goes, I could introduce you, you know, and I'm still thinking, she's married, you know, and she goes, but the guy's a drug. He's a drug addict. He's got, what do they call it? Manic bipolar. He's really messed up. And she says, you know, she's not happy with him. He's horrible to her. He terrorizes her, treats her horrible. She goes, you two would make a great couple. And I'm like, she's married. No matter how you keep slicing it, they're married, you know? So I was like, no. So I just, you know, I got myself a plate. I ate. And then after I ate, I was getting ready to go home. Now, it still wasn't dark yet. The sun was literally like 20 minutes from going down the horizon. And I thought, before I leave, I'm going to at least try to say hi to her. Just because she was so fascinating. So I worked my way through the crowd. It was pretty crowded. It's a big party. And she's, of course, talking to like five people at once, you know, just da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, you know, in Spanish. And everybody's just laughing at the stuff she's saying. And, you know, again, just center of the party. So I got up to her, you know, and I put out my hand and I said, well, you know, I'm Connie's friend. I work with her. You know, just wanted to say hello. And I'm kind of yelling really loud because the band is still playing and everybody's shouting and talking. And she looks at me and smiles and kind of shakes my hand really quickly. And then somebody asked her something and then she talked to them. And then, you know, she was right back to talking to all these people. So we really didn't talk at all. So I was like, oh, well. So I get in my car and I go home. Now it's dark. And, you know, that was the end of that day. And I thought, well, my friend's wife, she probably meant well, but meh, you know, what was I to expect? Well, I couldn't stop thinking about her. So when I get back to work on Monday, I asked my friend Connie, who I was training, I said, you know, that woman that was at your party, that friend of yours, the one you said's married, the life of the party. And she goes, yeah. I said, so, you know, I mean, if I wanted to talk to her, I mean, what would be her phone number? And she got all excited. She goes, oh, I know you guys will get along great. Da, da, da. I'm like, yeah, but she is married. She goes, no, here's her number. So I get home later in the week and I, you know, later in the week, I get out the number and I, you know, I'm trying to think of how I'm gonna, like, what am I going to say? Hey, this is that guy that shook your hand at the party last weekend. I mean, I really couldn't come up with something, but that's pretty much what I led with. So when I called the number and this woman, this beautiful, sweet, gregarious woman answered the phone, I started speaking and I said, hey, you know, I'm Connie's friend and I met you at the party. Do you remember? And I guess all there is confusion on the other side because she doesn't speak a word of English. So we ended up hanging up without saying anything. And then I go to my friend Connie. I'm like, why didn't you tell me she doesn't speak English? She goes, oh, yeah. She doesn't speak any English. Don't you know Spanish? I'm like, no, I don't speak Spanish. I mean, I know taco, enchilada, cerveza. I go, but I didn't speak Spanish. I never learned it. But I couldn't forget about this woman. So I got a book on Spanish, and I spent 3 months learning Spanish every day. I was a single guy. I wasn't dating anybody. If I had free time, I was learning Spanish. I was motivated. I wanted now to have a conversation with this woman. So I spent 3 months learning Spanish and finally mustered up the chutzpah to call her again on the phone. And this time in extremely poor, broken Spanish, we had a conversation. Very general stuff, you know, this is who I am, you know, I know you through my friend Connie, and where are you from? Mexico. Big surprise. And we, day after day, I practiced my Spanish having conversations with her. And we did that for like 2 months. And she said, yeah, I left my husband. I'm living with my sister who lived across the street from Connie. She goes, I'm in a tiny little trailer, literally tiny. We're talking like 6 feet by 8 feet, like really small, small, like a small trailer you would take camping or something, really small. Just had a twin bed, and it was her and her daughter. And we got to talking, and you know, she mentioned, oh, it gets so cold, you know. By this time it was already getting towards winter. She goes, oh, it's so cold, you know, because the You know, we don't have electricity, you know, at least they had electricity, but every night, you know, the brother-in-law, she's staying with her sister, but the brother-in-law was a real cheapskate. So before they went to bed, every night, what he would do is he would unplug the extension cord that went to her little trailer in the backyard so that after 9 p.m. or so, she didn't have any electricity. So I ended up working it out, and I talked to the sister, who did speak some English. I said, look, can you talk to your husband and tell him to knock it off, to leave the electricity on? Because I want to buy her an electric blanket so that they can stay warm at night, because there's no heater in that thing. So she did. She bugged her husband and said, don't you dare unplug that cord. So then I went down to Target and I bought her a electric blanket. I gave it to Connie because I still hadn't met her. All these months, I hadn't met her since that party. And so I gave the electric blanket to Connie after work, and she took it and gave it to her. And then we talked on the phone, and she was like, oh my God, this is a lifesaver. Now my daughter and I were warm. He's leaving the electric on, and now we're warm. Thank you. And so we build rapport for like 3, 4 months. And then I was like, so when are you going to divorce your husband or not? And she says, well, we really weren't legally married in the United States. We weren't even married, I believe, in Mexico. She goes, but I guess you have to go to court to get child support and declare, you know, a separation. She goes, I don't know how to do any of that. I can't read English. I can't speak English. Now, I had already knew the process because I'd been through it myself. Plus, I just have a fascination with law, so I knew about the whole family law and how it works and how to get a restraining order and a garnishment and child support. I knew how to do all this stuff. So I said, well, tell you what, I'm not a lawyer, but I can be your interpreter. Because by this time I'd been practicing English for about 6, 7 months. I said, tell you what, I can fill out the paperwork, you sign it, I'll help you submit it. I'll pay the fees. And when we go to court for the restraining order and the other things, I will translate your Spanish to English to the court and their English to Spanish. I said, I can do that. And I wasn't even thinking like, because I wanted to marry her. I just thought it really pissed me off that her husband was just so evil. He was threatening to kidnap their daughter and drop her in some random spot in Mexico just so that she'd never see her daughter again. That's how bad this guy was. And he was, again, manic bipolar, taking meth. He was just literally out of his mind, threatened to kill me, I don't know how many times, tried to find out where I lived. So, long story short, that woman that I met before the sun went down on the same day that my friend's wife said, today you're going to meet the next woman who you will marry. A year after meeting her, we got married. And we were married for 10 years. And it was a great marriage. There were other things that happened that had a lot to do with finances at the time and stress and doing a catering company, working full time, doing real estate. It really affected our marriage. But as a relationship, we both loved each other. It's just we both caved in under the financial stress. And sadly, it led to our divorce. But for 10 years, it was the happiest 10 years I'd had in my life up to that point. She was a great woman. I mean, it was like one big long honeymoon. You know, we were 10 years later still playing grab ass in the kitchen. It was great. Everybody wanted to be like us. They wanted that kind of marriage. We respected each other, loved each other, took care of each other, looked out for each other. I mean, she would literally take a bullet for me. She one time got so sick because she had very low blood pressure. She had a heart murmur. And one night she's like, get me to the hospital, get me to the hospital. And we'd already bought a house by this time. And so there we go. I get her to the hospital like 3 o'clock in the morning. And she's in there and her blood pressure's really low and she's fading in and out and I'm trying to keep her awake and the doctors are doing everything they can. And she's like really cold and she's shaking and I'm like, no, I finally find this person that no, this can't end this way. But the doctors were telling me this doesn't look good. This doesn't look good. We got to get her blood pressure up. And I remember sitting in that room, it was semi-dark, you know, it was like middle of the night. They just had the basic lights on. And I'm sitting there by the bed and I'm holding her hand. It's really cold. And she told me, she said, if I die tonight, it's okay because I finally know what love is. That's how good of a relationship we had. That's the woman I ended up meeting the very day that this prophetess boldly said, before the sun goes down today, you're going to meet the woman you're going to marry. So I look at that and I go, you know, that's not something that just happens. Does everybody have this gift of prophecy? No. Again, I would say very few, like half of a percent of believers. I don't think there's a big demand for it. I don't think it's what God's doing right now. But there are a few people that genuinely have this. And in the old days, in the Old Testament, if somebody said, I'm a prophet, you know what they did to a Jew who said they're a prophet and they prophesy something and it doesn't come true? They stoned him to death. You didn't play around back then saying, oh, I got the gift of prophecy. Okay, first time you get it wrong, you're a dead man. That's how they handled it back then. So a lot to think about. Dreams, visions. You know, I believe it's not as predominant as people would like it to be. And when they find that they can't find somebody to interpret their dream or figure out what this omen means or this sign, that could lead to them asking the wrong people. So if you find yourself like, I'm at a crossroads, I need an answer, I need to know what direction should I go in? What does the Bible say to do? In private, you don't have to go to church. You don't have to go to a priest. You now have a direct line to God. He can hear your thoughts before you hear them. Imagine that. Before you hear the sound of your mind's voice putting the sentence together, God sees that thought coming into your head. And everything you feel about the intensity of that problem, God has tapped into that. There's nothing about you he doesn't know. So you can speak directly to God yourself. You don't need a medium. You don't need a witch. You don't need a psychic. You can talk directly to God and say, you know the messed up situation I'm in right now. You know how important this decision is. You know how confused I am. Can you give me some direction? Now, don't expect, boom, oh, now I know what to do. God just answered that. No, expect to then do the other side of the communication. Now that you have prayed and made yourself known to God, hey, here's where I'm at. Pick up a Bible, start reading it. Don't just do like some people do and they go, okay, God, I'm gonna open the Bible to a random page and I'm gonna read this. Believe me, people do this. I'm gonna open the Bible to a random place and whatever it says in that verse, that's the answer to my question. Okay, you may as well use a magic eight ball because now you're turning the Bible into an instrument of divination. Don't do that. Just read. Read the Gospels. Read Proverbs. Read Ecclesiastes. You know, read Romans. Read Hebrews. Heck, read Genesis. Somewhere in the process, you're going to get your answer. And it might not even be like, oh, epiphany, now it's in my brain. Oh, now I know what to do. God has this thing called providence, where he arranges the circumstances around you. And just like a water going downhill, he'll lead you. You won't even realize it. And next thing you know, you've gotten your answer. You find yourself doing whatever it was that, if you're open to doing his will, you find yourself circumstantially, providentially, the word providence means to provide for. He will provide the circumstances to give you the direction you need. And if you're waiting for a voice to come out of the corner of the room, A, God doesn't do that. B, if you do hear a voice coming out of the room, don't trust it. Because God doesn't do it that way. Why? Wouldn't things be a whole lot easier if God could just make an unplugged radio, speak his voice out, and tell us what to do? How much faith would that require? See, it takes faith to ask God for something, and then just like the people of Moses leaving Egypt, and then they spend year after year walking in the desert, things don't look good, it's hot, this is hard. It takes faith to keep stepping forward every day. So, just some things to think about. And we'll talk about something else next time.